Hi students, I welcome you all for control system lectures. In the previous class I have discussed a numerical problem on polar plot. As earlier I mentioned that there are two ways to solve this polar plot. One is by giving random values of omega so that we can compute a magnitude and phase for a different set of omega values, and we need to observe the omega value where our plot will intersect -180 degrees. And also for different set of omega values, we can compute magnitude also, where we need to get the magnitude is equal to 1. So that we can compute gain crossover frequency and phase crossover frequency, thereby we can estimate the stability of the system. Right, that is one way of solving polar plot. In this class, today's class, I am going to explain the second method. In this method, as I mentioned earlier, the first three steps would be same as the previous method which we discussed, and from the fourth step, what we will be doing is we will be separating the real and imaginary parts. Based on the given transfer function, we will be solving a real part is equal to 0 or imaginary part we have to equate it to 0. It depends on the transfer function clearly. If you are having a type 0 system, we need to equate real part is equal to 0. If you have a type 1 system, we need to equate imaginary part to 0, right? The reason is the intersection point. We need to find the intersection point. So when we solve the numerical problem, we'll be you can understand what exactly that intersection point I meant by. Thereby, how can we equate the real and imaginary parts to 0 based on the requirement, based on the application. Right, so that we can directly compute the value of omega, right, the magnitude at particular omega value. That particular omega value will be calculating based on the intersection point. So let's start the numerical problem to make it more clear. So I actually solved it before, pre-solved it, and I'll be explaining this problem for time consuming. I just written the whole problem before, and here I'll be explaining it, right? So this is the transfer function given, open loop transfer function. G of s is equal to 20 by s into s plus 1 into s plus 2. In the previous class, the transfer function is as same as this, actually same transfer function we have used, but what we computed is based on the method 1. Right, in this class we will be dealing with the method 2. Right, so the first step is as common as the previous step. We need to substitute s equal to j omega. Once you substitute s equal to j omega, what you get is 20 by j omega into 1 plus j omega into 2 plus j omega. Right, then the next step is to write the given transfer function in polar form. By writing the transfer function in polar form, we will be getting a magnitude and phase separately. We can segregate magnitude and phase. So if you observe this given transfer function, if you write the magnitude expression for that, it will be 20 by omega into 1 plus omega square into 1 plus 4 plus omega square. How we get this? You need to just take the transfer function, the coefficient of it, root of 1 square plus omega square, j square will be 1, right? Therefore, here since we kept omega outside, it is actually omega square. Since we taken from the root out, it will be omega. That's how we get the magnitude. And for the phase, g of j omega, since there are three poles, one pole at origin, one pole at minus 1 and one pole at minus 2, what we will be getting is minus 90 minus tan inverse of omega and minus tan inverse of omega by 2. Right, this is the same step we discussed in the previous problem also. Right, now if you observe, what we need to do in the third step is we need to compute magnitude and the phase for omega equal to 0 to omega equal to infinity. That means actually we mentioned, since we are dealing with the frequency response analysis, we need to observe the response of the system with the varying frequency. Right? Varying frequency in the sense from frequency 0 to infinity. So as the starting point, we can compute the frequency, I mean magnitude plot at particular frequency, right? If they are given a certain frequency, we can compute that based on polar form, polar expressions which we got it here. Right? Now at omega equal to 0, what we get, if you substitute omega equal to 0 here, I can name this as 1, can name this as expression 1, and this will be 2. Okay, substitute omega equal to 0 in 1 so that you can compute magnitude of the system. Substitute omega equal to 0, 0 into 0 into 0, like whatever it adds to 0, it will be 0 actually. Root of 0, it will be multiplied with 0, therefore whole thing will become 0. 20 by 0 is infinity, therefore magnitude will be infinity. Right? Now if you substitute 0 in phase expression, that is equation 2, what you get is minus tan inverse of 0. What you get is 0. This will be minus tan inverse of 0, that will become 0. Therefore, whatever leftover term in phase is minus 90. So, in the previous class, if you remember, we discussed about the type 0 and type 1 system. We can estimate where exactly the plot will start and where exactly it will end. So, if you observe the transfer function given, it is a type 1 system, right? This is type 1 system. Therefore, the plot will definitely start at minus 90. Like by seeing transfer function itself, you can tell that since it is having one pole, it will directly start at minus 90. Anyway, we have the procedure for cross verification. We can substitute omega values and we can get the phase. So once you get the phase, just substitute, put the plot for the phase at frequency omega equal to 0. For omega equal to 0, what you get is minus 90. And one more thing is at omega equal to infinity, just substitute omega equal to infinity in 1 and 2 so that we can get the magnitude and the phase. For 1, what we got is at omega equal to infinity, g of j omega will be 0. And the phase will be minus 270. So from all these four terms, at omega equal to 0 and omega equal to infinity, we will be getting a magnitude as well as the phase. So from using this step 3, you can actually put the points in the polar plot at omega equal to 0. That means this point where it is making minus 90. So this is nothing but omega equal to 0. This is the starting point and the plot would start definitely here. And we don't know where exactly it will intersect the real axis. For that, we need to go for step 4. And we know the ending point also. Ending point is omega equal to infinity, where it will end at the phase of minus 270. Right? So we need to construct the polar plot such that the intersection point should be estimated. Right? So to estimate the intersection point, the next step is to separate the real and imaginary parts. So we need to take a complex conjugate of the transfer function of the g of j omega polar form, right? 20 by j of j omega into 1 plus j omega into 2 plus j omega. Therefore, for this denominator factor, what will be the complex conjugate? Complex conjugate will be minus here actually, right? Since there is no real term, this will go and this will be get cancelled. We will get only these two terms, right? So once you solve for real and imaginary parts, the final expression we get here is minus j into 20, 20j into 1 minus j omega into 2 minus j omega divided by omega into 1 plus omega square into 4 plus omega square. This is the whole expression. Using this, we need to segregate real and imaginary parts. If you observe, we have a minus j here, and just multiply this whole numerator, and so that whatever the j terms are there, you write it as imaginary term. Whatever the leftover constant terms, you can write it in real part. So this is how we get real and imaginary parts. Now, as I mentioned, the plot will start at minus 90 and it will intersect at real axis. When the plot is intersecting at a real axis, what we need to take? We need to take imaginary part should be 0. So how to decide this? We can decide this based on the step 3 actually. If you observe the step 3, we know that it is definitely starting at imaginary point and it is actually going towards the real axis. So when it is going towards the real axis, we have to make imaginary part to 0. Remember, we have to make imaginary part to 0 if the plot is starting at if the plot is starting at imaginary axis, we have to make real equal to 0 and vice versa. In this problem, we know that the plot has started in the imaginary axis. Therefore, we have to make real part to 0. This real part, as the plot actually started, where it started is this point. Here it started imaginary and it is tending towards the real axis. When it is tending towards the real axis, for the real intersection, imaginary should be 0. This is the real intersection, right? So for the real intersection, imaginary should be 0. So just consider this imaginary part, and equate this to 0. When you equate it to 0, denominator term will be 0 and leftover is only numerator, right? So equate it to 0 to compute omega equal to minus 2. So once you compute here, the numerator part, what we get is omega equal to root 2. So remember, the intersection point is making the frequency of root 2. Here it is starting, here going this way, and it will be ending here, and this particular point here omega value will be root 2. That is what it means. Intersection point is nothing but minus 180. In the previous problem also, we are trying to give a different random values of omega such that we can get this minus 180. Here also we are doing the same. We are doing the same thing, but here directly there is a method to compute that. That is making imaginary part to 0 or real part to 0 and vice versa, depends on the transfer function, given transfer function, right? Now, once you get the intersection point, we need to compute the distance of this intersection point from the origin. How to compute that? We need to compute magnitude. This is nothing but magnitude, right? This is nothing but magnitude, the distance from the origin. So to compute this, at omega equal to 0 minus at omega equal to root 2, we need to compute the magnitude. So just substitute omega equal to root 2 in the magnitude expression, that is equation 1, right? Just go to the equation 1, just substitute omega equal to root 2 here. From where we got root 2 is the intersection point, from the intersection point. So just remember the sequence, okay? Once you substitute omega equal to root 2, what we get is magnitude as 3.33, okay? Here we get 3.33. This is nothing but the magnitude, that is the distance from the origin. So here, so similarly, what we have to do is for magnitude, we got 3.3 from the origin. So for the phase angle, we have to substitute root 2 in phase expression, that is equation 2. substitute the phase in equation 2, right? Now the angle, what this is just to verify, because default, by default we know that it will be intersecting. Intersection means that is nothing but minus 180 degrees. This intersection point is nothing but minus 180 degrees. And to cross verify, we have to substitute this root 2 in the phase expression, and we will be getting minus 180. And that is how we can cross verify that, right? So this is how we can compute, I mean we can plot the polar plot if you have a type 1 system or given transfer function using method 2. And one more problem we will see for type 0 system, same methodology will apply. Same methodology will apply for type 0 system, right? So this is the problem which was given. Draw a polar plot for a given transfer function g of s into h of s is equal to 10 by s plus 2 into s plus 4. This is nothing but type 0 system. So by default we can understand, by this time with this experience of three problems or so till now, which we solved from third problem, right? So with this experience we can understand where exactly the plot comes, plot actually starts. If they give you a type 0 system, definitely the plot is going to start in real axis, and it is going to intersect the imaginary axis, and it will end up somewhere in the origin. So this is the default thing. If there, by transfer function we can estimate this, but we need to estimate the distance here, distance and the phase, right? We need to estimate this part. This is important. We know it will intersect, but where exactly it will be intersecting, that is what we need to compute. Okay, so the first three steps will be same actually. Just as the first step, substitute s equal to j omega, write down the g of j omega and h of j omega expression, and as a second step, convert the given transfer function in terms of a polar form. So polar form will be this way. And next thing is, once you convert into polar form, you can segregate real and imaginary parts, or I mean magnitude and the phase expressions. So you need to segregate magnitude and the phase. This will be the magnitude, this will, I make it as equation 1, this will be equation 2. So now the third step is to compute magnitude and phase at omega equal to 0 and omega equal to infinity. So when omega is equal to 0, magnitude we'll get is 1.25. Actually just substitute magnitude omega equal to 0 in the equation 1, right? You get magnitude as 1.25 and the phase will be 0, right? Similarly, omega equal to infinity, if you substitute, then you'll get magnitude as 0 and phase will be minus 180. So from till here, we estimated, we understood that it will start at real axis and it will end at origin, because at omega equal to infinity, it is making magnitude as 0. At omega is equal to 0, it is making magnitude of 1.25. This is nothing but 1.25, that distance from the origin, right? This particular thing, this is nothing but 1.25. So it's actually a distance. Magnitude is nothing but a distance from the point, certain point origin, right? So it is making 1.25 and the phase will be 0. Phase will be 0 means it is actually starting at 0, right? Now, so next step is to separate real and imaginary parts. To get that, for the given polar form, you need to take a complex conjugate of polar form. So that denominator, whatever is there, just put minus and multiply and divide it with complex conjugate, so that you can separate real and imaginary parts. So here you get a real part and imaginary part. From the third step, as I mentioned, it will be starting in the real axis and going towards the imaginary axis and ending at 0. So this means what we need to do, we are trying to estimate the point of intersection for the imaginary axis. If you want the imaginary axis, what you need to do, you need to make real axis to 0. Now you are trying to compute the imaginary axis. The reason is that we need to get the intersection point of imaginary axis. So if you want imaginary axis, we need to make a real part to zero. Therefore, from the separation of real and imaginary terms, you have to make a real part to zero. Right? Once you substitute a real part to zero, we'll get the omega value, that is 2 root 2 here. This is nothing but 2 root 2. So what does it tells us? It tells us that omega is 2 root 2. At omega 2 root 2, it is actually intersecting the imaginary axis. Right? I'll just draw the plot down here. So it is starting here. I'll just mention it. It will start here. Omega equal to 0. It is going towards this point and intersecting this. So this particular point is omega is equal to 2 root 2. So now what we need to get is, we got the omega value. Now we have to get the distance from the origin, this point. So we need to compute this part, this distance. What we need to do, we have to substitute omega equal to 2 root 2 in magnitude expression, in the imaginary part. So once you substitute omega equal to 2 root 2 in the imaginary part, right? This is an imaginary part. So substitute this one in magnitude. We have to, this is imaginary magnitude actually, imaginary line and magnitude of the given transfer function g of j omega. This is nothing but magnitude of g of j omega into h of j omega. So once you substitute 2 root 2 in magnitude expression, that is equation 1 in this problem, I'll just show you. So here, this one, once you substitute magnitude, you will be getting the magnitude at 2 root 2. 2 root 2 you have to substitute in this. So once you substitute 2 root 2, sorry, 2 root 2, and what you get here is 0.589. Either you can do this or you can just take directly imaginary part, because that is nothing but imaginary part, right? If you substitute omega in this imaginary part also, you'll get the same. Or by substituting omega in the magnitude plot also, they substitute 2 root 2 in the magnitude expression, so you get the magnitude at this particular omega. Okay, so this is how we can estimate the plot intersection, and thereby once you get this plot intersections, later you can actually compute the phase crossover frequency and gain crossover frequency as mentioned in the previous problem. Then you can get the phase margin and gain margin. You can compute the phase margin and gain margin. Right, now it will be going this way and going here. So you need to just find the intersection point, and once you get the intersection point, to get phase margin and gain margin, you have to compute phase crossover frequency and gain crossover frequency. This is nothing but the phase crossover frequency. It is minus 180, the intersection point. In the previous problem also, intersection point is important. Intersection point with the axis. Once you get that, you can compute the gain margin. Gain margin is equal to 1 by g of, magnitude g at phase crossover frequency, and similarly gain margin, phase margin is 180 plus phi at omega gc, gain crossover frequency, omega at gain crossover frequency. So this is how you can solve using the second method actually. Okay, so that's it for the class today, and we'll be discussing on Nyquist plot in the next class. Thank you for your attention.